So I'm Jim Geddes. For those of you who haven't met me before, I'm one of the original people who started the X-Men business some years ago, and worried about the web protocols for a while, and helped reform the X development stuff when X-36 stopped functioning, which is a tragedy. In any case, these days I'm working on the One Life Off the Child project that Nicholas Negroponte has started. He had been the director of the MIT Media Lab, but OLPC is a separate organization that's not part of MIT. The picture here is of a school in Cambodia that Nicholas had built. It doesn't cost very much to build a school in Cambodia, it turns out. He and other people at the Media Lab have been interested in helping kids learn with computers for about the last 7 years. So one of the things that he did some years ago was give a laptop to every kid in one of the schools. And this, of course, has both expected and unexpected consequences. The first problem was to convince the kids' parents that, in fact, they were supposed to use the laptops when they went home at night, because these computers were worth more than the houses that they were in, and the most valuable thing by far that the family had, right? So the first problem was just convincing them this is the kids' machine and they're really supposed to be able to be used, right, all the time. The next interesting observation was that for most of these kids, this was the first artificial light in their house. Okay, and that is not uncommon in many parts of the world. And so that has driven our thinking in a lot of ways, as you'll see. Our conventional laptops are really ill-suited for this sort of environment in a lot of ways. And so we're specifically, since nobody builds the right hardware, we're in the hardware business. It's not fundamentally what we're interested in. We're interested in helping kids learn. But until we can convince the world there's a real market for the unserved billion children in the world, we're in the hardware business. How long that will take to form, I don't know. So our initial goal is $100. We're not going to make it in the first generation. It looks like it'll be about $135. The next generation machines will make $100 price. There's been tons of newspaper articles. You've all heard about it. I want to sort of explain a little bit about the structure of this whole thing. The intent is that, the four reasons I'll get to later, to begin with, in most places, education is controlled by the government, for better or for worse. There's an observation that in Brazil and China, for example, they're spending about $20 per child per year. So, the observation is if you can make something for a quarter or $100, that in fact, the education budgets don't have to increase, because that often won't happen. We really want to get as cheap machines as possible. We get $100, the next goal will be $50. But the point being that a commercial company wouldn't have the motivation to keep making them cheaper typically. What they look for is they'll come in, enter at a lower price to get market share, and typically the price stays the same, the features go up, and they make and become more profitable with time, right? But we're trying to really push the market, and so we're a nonprofit association, or 501c6 or something like that. And a bunch of companies, not all of which you can see because the display or the screen isn't quite being driven right, sorry about that, have put out a few million dollars a piece to see us through building these. So that includes Google, Red Hat, 3M, News Corporation. The ones you can't read are Marvell, who made communications integrated circuits. You'll hear more about them later. AMD, we're using an AMD Geode processor. Brightstar, who you've probably never heard of, distributes something like 70 million cell phones per year. Nortel and so on. There are other, obviously, component suppliers of various sorts involved, including Quanta Computer. Quanta Computer is probably the largest computer company you've never heard of. There is statistically a 1 in 3 chance of the laptop in your lap having been made by Quanta. They make laptops for everybody. They make 32% of the laptops of the world. So they are the 10,000-pound gorilla in the laptop manufacturing business.
Yeah. They're in China?
They're based in Taiwan. Their manufacturing is outside of Shanghai. The point here is that marketing and distribution at this price point would take too much of the price. So we really want to avoid the retail channel. Software would be another big chunk. I'm not sure the top graph is correct. I think they would move. But we're trying to get to the point of building 5 to 10 million units next year. The point being that we need volume to make things cheap. By the time you would actually have a machine able to support Microsoft Windows XP for real, you end up with a $400 class machine just for Microsoft and Intel and so on and on. So we're trying to get something cheaper, and we can get there using Linux. From some arbitrary point of view, Linux is irrelevant to us. What matters is the kids learning. Okay. Now, we believe it's very important that the kids be able to take a machine apart all the way down to the bare iron, understand how computers work. It's a fundamental skill now in our society. So we are very much in the open source, free software camp. Okay? Linux has the most vibrant community by far, and it's the obvious choice, and it also is able to run on Flash and the like. Here's where we are. Last fall, you heard the big press in Tunis. We're talking with a bunch of countries. Brazil and Thailand are the furthest along. We're talking with others. I don't think we'll see real commitments until we have fully running prototypes this around, August or September, with the displays and the like. We're also trying to crack the nuts of China and India, and that's really tough. There are a number of principles out of all of this is scale. You can't make the price if you aren't doing this in really huge scale. So this is an attempt to do something at a scale that is really scarily large. To give you an idea, to get to the 5 to 10 million units is an order of the Xbox 360 RAM in a year. And they use 3 manufacturers. Now, we're using one, but it happens to be the biggest laptop manufacturer in the world. The price, I say, is floating. If the price goes down, or if the price of the components go down, then the price of the machines to the governments will go down as well. There's a component, so it's a cost plus thing. We have full access to Quanta's actual expenses. The way ODMs usually work is they basically bid to build a particular machine at a particular price point against other ODMs, and then they work like hell to figure out how to make the machine cheaper and cheaper and keep the difference. That's the business model they're usually in. This is a little bit different. They're working with us on a cost-plus basis. We're able to see what the prices are for all the components. That doesn't mean I can tell you the prices of all the components. Some of them are special deals that people are willing to cut with us. With a fixed percentage. They're taking a smaller percentage they would normally, but the only way a company like that can afford to do this is if there's a real return for stockholders. Okay. We want a really open system, and we mean open, and so that means that if Microsoft wants to put some flavor of Windows on the machine, more power to them. This is an open system. Okay. Since the economics of this are driven a lot by what the cost of textbooks are, we care a lot about being able to use it as a book. Okay? Because if it doesn't work well as a book, you got a real problem in the economic story. If you don't get your economics, this thing can't scale. Right? This is all about scale in many ways. That's why scale is at the top of the list. There's a billion kids out there. So, much as 5 to 10 million sounds like a big number, Understand the steady state, once you've equipped everybody, is probably the order of 200 million units per year. Okay? So we're still talking about it in our first year being a small, thing, even though by any other scale it's huge. I'm not sure what Mary Lou were doing in the university, but I started with a talk to Mary Lou Jepson or Sneaky to put together. But,
Do you have questions now or at the end?
I'm happy to take questions anytime.
You said that the Microsoft was to put Windows in the laptop, you're fine with that?
Yeah. How could we stop them? It's an open system.
But would you distribute that with Microsoft Windows inside?
We aren't going to, although PC is not.
Okay. So if they want to put it after they have been distributed?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately there's no way to stop, nor would we stop other things running on this machine. My opinion is that Microsoft is between a rock and a hard place and doesn't have appropriate software for this kind of hardware.
Yeah, but my point is that if Microsoft wants to put it afterward, after you have distributed and given it to the client, then
We aren't directly the distributors. Remember, the distributors are things like the Ministry of Education.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And so ultimately, we aren't in the final control about what goes on this machine, nor can we be.
This is I believe that it would be sad to try to create an open system that the kids can like disassemble until the end to the bare metal, and not have an operating system that they can do the same thing.
We can't, force the situation. You're asking us to do something which is literally the antithesis of what open systems is about. Okay. And yeah, there may be some consequences we don't like about that, but are we going to sacrifice our own principles?
But it would be nice to like convince governments, or at least
probably. Well, a lot of the governments really would prefer to ship something other than Microsoft
software.
Will that happen all over the world? Well, probably not, but that's the way it goes. Linux ultimately has to succeed on its own virtues. Let's make it succeed, okay?
Yeah.
And we're not going to do it by trying to control it.
Sure.
Okay? I mean, all that would do is have Microsoft more unhappy than they already are about this project. Because fundamentally, we don't have the right software right now. That's Windows CE is horribly insecure, and regular Windows XP is too big for this class machine.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, we have a lot of experience with being able to run Linux on, handheld and other portable small environments. This is actually a lot more machine than we've had in the PDA, as we'll see. Okay, so part of this whole game is how do you get to anything approximating $100? Some of the skepticism that you've heard in the press has been that there are lots of people who know what component prices are. Oh, let me step back a second. I missed one important point. The other piece of this price which is floating is that flash and DRAM are true commodities. So while we can get contracts on other parts, we can't control the price of RAM and DRAM. They're literally sold, they're futures markets, the whole of all wax. Okay, so when we talk to governments, we can say, what's happening is basically we're saying to governments, you'll commit this much money, we'll get you as many machines as we possibly can, but we can guarantee that that everything except flash and RAM will cost no more than this, right? And flash and RAM, might cause it to be higher than our estimates. We're going by the estimates of what flash and RAM ought to be next year, but as you know, once in a while there are, interesting fluctuations in those markets.
Like an earthquake in Taiwan, right?
What?
An earthquake in Taiwan.
For example,
yeah.
that's a real example. Or in Japan also, has had problems like that. Okay, so one of the interesting questions out of all of this is, well, how do you get to something approaching $100? Because lots of people know what the prices of things are, okay? And if you figure out, if you just think you're building a regular laptop, you're going to come up with a number that's at least of order $200 to manufacture. The largest single component of that is the flat panel display. Okay, Even if it's only like a 7.5 inch flat panel display, that's where like, you know, $90 of the cost would have to go. So Mary Lou Jepson was noting that, in fact, the costs in a conventional flat panel are not mostly the LCD, they're mostly elsewhere in the flat panel. They're in the polarizers, backlights, driver ICs, printed circuit boards, all that sort of stuff. So we're connectors. We're working on all of those things. And she's really one of the world's experts at display technology. And so she's invented a new form of LCD. It's a dual mode display. These numbers, by the way, are, as always, I never quite keep up. I should have reviewed this last night. We finally have nailed down the manufacturer of the display. And it turns out that for the plants that manufacturer has, the sweet spot for number of, what happens is you have a piece of mother glass that you make an LCD out of. Just like an integrated circuit, the question is how many can you fit on one big piece of glass, okay? And so there's a sweet spot determined geometrically by how many of these can be fit, right? So it turns out we're going to end up with about a 7.5 inch display of 1200 by 900 resolution. I think that's actually closer to 200 dpi. In one mode, it's black and white, the grayscale, and it's reflective, which means that it's sunlight readable. You'll be able to take this out into the bright sunlight and use it. This is not true of the existing laptops. It is really needed for many environments in which this machine is likely to be used. You don't necessarily have a dark room to work in. Okay? The other mode is a lower resolution color display, which is transmissive. Okay? But it doesn't use a conventional backlight. It uses an LED, and we hope it's going to use. This is Huck, doesn't have, may not have the.
What does mean speed?
It's a brightness term of some sort. I don't claim to. I'm not an expert at that. Okay, so the basic scheme is a diffractive scheme. You can print plastic to become a diffraction grating and end up separating the colors from a white light LED to illuminate the appropriate pixels in this interesting pattern. And you end up with something which will work out, of order, you need three pixels for every one, obviously. So it's a lower resolution in color. It'll be something higher than 640 by 480. In some ways, it isn't just the trivial 3-to-1 computation you get from 11, from what this is before we only finally set what the final resolution would be like last week on the display, or maybe it was the week before, I don't remember. So these numbers are slightly wrong. The basic principle is correct. The power consumption in grayscale mode is less than 1 watt. Running the backlight will consume up to 1 watt. A conventional laptop with a conventional backlight is often consuming 6 to 8 watts. Okay. So again, we're going back to the fact we want a human-powered machine. We have to have a human-powered machine. There's lots of people who do not have electricity, lots of kids who do not have electricity at home, and often not even in the schools. Okay, so here's the basic machine modulo. I need to update the the specs again. It's a Geo, which is an x86 architecture machine. 128 meg of RAM, half a gigabyte of NAND flash. It'll be running DFFS2 on that, which does data compression. So it gets about a, for software and data and typical data, non-compressed stuff, it gets about a factor of two compression. So one way to look at it is we can probably fit about the amount of software we get on the live CD with space left over for content and the way of software. So the display, as I said, is a little bit higher resolution than what's on the slide. There are three external USBs with power for only one. It's USB 2, so it's possible to plug a USB 2 disk drive into it. I'll get to that a bit more later. We're using a Marvell wireless chip. You may never have heard of Marvell because they're not typically being used in it. They've mostly been used in embedded systems. The reason why we're interested in this is that this has an outboard ARM9 processor and 92 kilobytes of RAM. What this means is we can put a routing table and forwarding software and run it outboard while the processor is suspended, the main processor is suspended. We can have the machine still able to forward packets in the mesh network. Okay? There are a number of novel things about this machine. This is one of them. Okay? The display is the other really big novel thing about this about the machine. Sort of everyday codec, it happens to be an analog device, is 1888. Volume out, microphone in, stereo speakers. It's going to have a rubber membrane keyboard that actually we finally have some samples that seem to work okay. That's because of dust and dirt and water. Okay, a conventional keyboard probably would not survive long enough to be tolerable. A touchpad on it. It's going to be, it's intended to be a kid's machine. So think of it as, we're really trying to make it look something other than corporate grab. We're taking care about the industrial design. It's nickel metal hydride batteries with an optional outboard generator. We had to give up on the internal generator idea, which Nicholas has really wanted to do. The reality is of how much power a kit can actually produce and the ergonomics of what a kit can produce and what using what sort of muscles at this power level just didn't make sense. We intend to ship Linux BIOS on the machine, so you'll actually be able to see what's going on. This was just one of the early prototypes, early industrial design prototypes. The point is that we intend it to be usable as essentially a conventional laptop, or as an ebook sort of thing, or a thing for just playing games on, with some buttons on the front, that sort of thing. This is another physical model that was made just to show the kinds of things. We actually now have the final industrial design chosen. I don't think I have a good rendering of it. These were some recent industrial design samples. So it'll look something like the machine on the left. In terms of having a handle and stuff like that. So in January we got really kicked off the engineering of this project, and we were staring at the reality that the machine might take between 2.5 to 3.5 watts of power to run. That doesn't sound like much. Your laptops are probably consuming 10 times as much. But the reality is that a small child can generate a lot less than that, or generate only 5 to 10 watts, and not for, less power than we hope for less time. So we have to get a reasonable return on the effort, right? The kid, we don't want the kids spending all their time cranking, right? Or generating electricity. We want them to spend most of their time learning. So our goal has always been 10x. So there were a couple of obvious things that occurred to us. We really want the mesh network on all the time. And because we really want to be able to, for a mesh to be effective, you need to be able to forward packets for others as much as possible. And if a kid's not confident there's going to be battery left when they use it, they're going to try to disable the wireless. And even if you don't make that easy to do, they'll figure out how. It's only a matter of when, right? So we really needed a way to have the mesh able to be on even with the rest of the machine off. Okay, and that's what drove. So Quanta introduced us to Marvell. We didn't even know this chip existed. And the Atheros folks weren't even willing to commit in their next generation for what we needed. So it was a pretty non-brainer choice. And the Marvell folks have probably been doing a great job. The driver, there's a get tree for the driver. Right now we can't, the current firmware still has some, that loads into the Marvell chip, still has a little embedded operating system yet release the blob of firmware. However, our intent is, and we'd love help, is to replace that little thing with something like TinyOS, which is open source, at which point the firmware would be open, but that will probably, may very well need help from the community to actually see done. I say that because the reality will be that by the time we finish get this machine done, we'll be having to worry about the next generation machine, and it won't be an issue there. Maybe the help may be in order, but right now to get at the code that goes into the Marvell chip itself, you have to sign an NDA to get access to it of some sort. But it's not where we or Marvell want to be in the future. The driver itself is in a good tree on Dave Woodhouse's machine at the moment, so you can actually get at it, that sort of thing. The other observation is the CPU is just usually refreshing the screen or forwarding packets. So, CPU most of the time is idle. What do we need a CPU for? If we can have the display on, we can have the wireless chip on. Okay? So, necessity being the mother of invention, we're going to turn off the CPU and most of the system and leave the wireless and possibly display on. Okay? There's a chip we're building. We have to build some sort of a chip anyway called the VCOM chip, which drives the LCD. There's, in some sense, architecturally, these unified memory architecture things aren't great for low-power things. You'd really like a frame buffer to be outboard, so that you don't have to have the processor on to read out the frame buffer, okay? So the way the VCOM chip works is that it's got a small RAM chip, and it takes the pixels and stores them in that RAM chip. And so we will be able to power off the main processor, go to suspend to RAM, and leave the screen running. Okay. Same thing goes for the wireless. So we expect that for a lot of things like just looking at something, which happens a lot of the time, like most of you right now are not actually typing on your displays. That will be in the half to 1.5 watt kinds of range. So depending upon screen and wireless kinds of use. So that gets us into a much better, though not a wonderful ratio. It takes about 0.5 watt to run the wireless chip. You might think, it should only be when transmitting, but the reality is that the signal processing on the receive side of a wireless chip is significant. So a wireless chip does take an order 0.5 watt. Even if it's just listening. So here's the sort of good and bad and the ugly. Turning off the CPU gets us roughly to our power consumption goals. With the VCOM and Marvell wireless chip makes this work. The geode unfortunately takes about 150 milliseconds to wake up again, which is unfortunate. It's slower with many other chips.
Have you considered any other chip than geode or some ARM or MIPS or?
Here's the issue. Experience by us who work on handhelds, and I was one of the people who started the handhelds.org effort of Linux on handheld devices. But if you see Linux on any sort of PDA or fund thing, it all goes back through handhelds.org in some sense. We did that with stuff first, and people took it and ran with it. The experience is that if you don't have an FPU, you have a lot of porting effort, particularly for multimedia stuff with open source software. It's sort of tolerable when you have a very limited number of applications. You sit down and you rewrite the individual applications. It's not tolerable on a general purpose machine. So one of the requirements has been having a conventional floating point unit. Right now, it turns out that the geode is the best game in town. That won't be true a year from now, but it is today. Mark Foster, who's our hardware lead architect, and surveyed 320 chips or something in January. The thing that came closest to what we needed to where the geode was a PowerPC, which actually did have an FPU, but then had a gigabit Ethernet embedded on the chip too. So nobody, you know, it isn't that we're happy about the geode, it happens to be the least evil alternative right now. And so we're telling all the people in the semiconductor industry what we want, right? And on over a year, it's actually possible for them to take, the way these kinds of highly integrated chipsets or chips work is that they have pre-existing designs they plop down and interconnect. And so with a year or more, you know, advanced learning, we can actually get a chip that will meet our needs. So second generation, we'll certainly be lower power, and I'm not going to predict what architecture, I'm not going to predict whether it will be AMD or not, even if they're a sponsor. I mean, they're going to have to live up to our needs and meet what we need if they're going to play in the future too, just the way Google's done similar things with Intel being on their board, and they use a lot of AMD chips. In any case, the bad news, of course, is that we can't turn off the processor between keystrokes. And the S1 state happens to be broken on this machine, so this is sort of too bad. But any substantial pause in your machine, we intend to make the machine go to sleep. We've arranged that the decon will be able to turn the switch back on almost instantaneously. So if you've suspended the processor and the screen is off, as soon as you hit a key, your screen will go live again, even if it takes another 200 milliseconds to get the processor going.
What is this one?
That's power management jargon for a state in which so your processor is not doing any instructions, but you still have your system power applied in various places. S3 is actually where you turned off power to the processor and other parts of the peripherals. Okay.
Is it necessary to have the CPU running at full speed? Is there some way to get it up to something that may not be full speed, but it's enough to process a
keystroke? Not on the geode. It's relatively low powered in the first place, but there's no frequency or voltage scaling in the geode. There are in some of the other lower power embedded chips that are integer only.
So it won't execute any instruction before it's before that time.
The geode is very slow about getting its phase lock loops stable before turning on the clocks. Its PLL stuff isn't very good. It's what it boils down to.
Yeah, but couldn't you do with PLL just takes the external frequency? And so just skip the PLL step?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't work. Doing that transition is just too hard, apparently. We intend to ship a Linux BIOS on it. Right now we're using Inside BIOS. The Inside BIOS folks were really, really, I want to thank them, because they had no economic motivation, but they were kind enough to even though we aren't going to ship their BIOS, they spent a couple of days to get their BIOS up on our hardware, so we have a BIOS on day one. Getting Linux BIOS up on this particular machine has been harder than we expected. It is now more or less up as of about the last week. It doesn't get to the point where we can switch over to it, but I expect over the next month or so it will. It obviously allows us complete control, and with the kind of power management we want to do, we care a lot about that. We really would also like to do the boots and installs over the wireless network. Experience from the handheld world is that even when we got the iPad installed down to a compact flash card that you plugged into it that did a brain, personality transplant, the physical, having to have that device and physically, going through the steps for each machine is really boring. What you really like is a machine that can, you turn on and it does the right thing the first time when you boot it. Needing something physical to plug into the machine is another logistical headache. So we don't want to do that. There's no royalty, so we'll save a small amount of money there. Inside stuff is not much. But also, kids can see how computers really work all the way down to the iron, which we think is important for the kids to care. Most kids don't care, but some do. And we want the kids to be able to understand how computing works. It's been a big piece of most people's lives. And if we can start building $100, $50 machines, it'll be a big part of everybody's lives all over the world. Okay. So this is up now on the GX2 pretty much after the last few days. There's a lot of work we need help from. There's memory consumption. A lot of the current code is just sloppy. It's sloppy both in design and buggy. Okay? So Linux is suffering from bloat, maybe not quite as badly as Windows, but it's really a problem. Now, from doing some investigation, certain key applications are, like Firefox, are literally hemorrhaging memory. The cache management code is currently effectively broken anytime you use tabs on Firefox. If you look at it, you will see that it is, if you consume 300 to 500 megabytes in a day's use, it never is giving memory back. People have finally realized that there's a problem here and are beginning to work on it. But if you wonder why our desktop has unpredictable performance, a large part of the reason is that we have a number of applications which are memory hogs and or leak memory that are causing things to get paged out. And so rather than getting instantaneous response at a context switch, you're waiting for something to page out or page in, and things are slow. So the work that needs to happen for applications to be useful to OLTC is work that will help everybody to about the 90% level, okay? At the Linux and Linux environment level, okay? The amount of stuff you need for OLTC is actually very small, right? So this is all to your benefit to become much more aware of. You will all benefit a lot if you go help analyze and fix these problems. Federico Amino Quintera has started doing a lot of analysis of this sort on the GNOME environment, is making good strides. Even so, we'll obviously avoid or won't be able to use things that are huge pigs. And one of the nice things we have about the reality of our Linux is, in some sense, the huge number of choices, right? So we will obviously make some choices. So I'm trying to make a plea to everybody here that if you want your applications to run fast, not only should they not leak, but memory is accessing memory is very slow. For every memory reference you make that has to go all the way to RAM, you have many, many, many instructions. So the way you can often make your code run 2 or 3 or 5 times faster is by reducing the memory footprint of your data structures. So, this is serious stuff, folks. This a lot of people grew up in an era when memory was the ratio of time required to reference memory versus instructions was a lot closer to 1-to-1 than it is today. It's now like can be as bad as 300-to-1 kinds of numbers, right? More typically 20-to-50-to-1. Okay, if you want your code to run fast, make it small, okay? So there's lots more work to do here. There's obviously some amount of limit there. You know, the amount of footprint we have on this is we're not running a disk drive. Disk drives are heavy, fragile, expensive. Okay, and so they have three strikes, you're out. So this is a flash-based machine. You've got half a gigabyte this year. That's $7. Okay. A conventional disk would be something like $20 or $30. And power, and then another couple of watts, the other problem with conventional disks, right? So data compression helps some, but obviously things that you use huge amounts of space on a disk is an issue. By the way, all this sort of stuff will help the LPSP people now in.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
And that's what I would add on, that this is not a particular question for one laptop or child product. It's, we have probably run, we have schools, municipalities that run thousands of thin clients. And the measures I get with upgrading to 2.0 of school Linux was that they turn off the swap and then the thin clients went black. And it's not one thin client, it's half of the thin clients when you do an upgrade. And this is, and the answer from the community was that, well, you can just buy new equipment, for God's sakes. But these municipalities, their choice with their money is that they haven't the 38,000 euro to do this upgrade, or they haven't the time spending to add on 64 RAM to the machines. So this is exactly the same problem as one laptop Peshal are into. Also with half thick or diskless workstations. And the thing is that we are competing with pupils that are used to using Microsoft in our Western world. So they are hugely disappointed because they have at home 3.2 gigahertz processor. The equipment at home is just too cool. So in the other side, you have the municipality that doesn't have the money. So if we could give the same user experience for the users.
Also, make your machines run a hell of a lot better.
Yeah.
Okay? It'll help everybody here.
Thank you.
There's a bunch of stuff to do, you know, in user land, like flashing cursors that go on forever, applets that just sort of update themselves forever without being power aware. There's some stupid applications that like to burn power with animations that go on forever. FlashDot will get installed if we can't get the macromedia folks to do something more sane. I told them this too. there's lots of work to do in toolkits, desktop standards, that sort of thing. We clearly will probably want to have, really know when we're doing something like a full screen ebook reader, because then, you know, suspending all the time makes perfect sense, right? All this sort of stuff is also friendly for LTSP and Learn, okay? And most of this work will help just things in general. There's some additional model power tricks we intend to do. We intend to drive the flat panel slowly whenever possible to save power. This is not novel to us. I mean, if you look at cell phone chips and panels are doing likewise, it should be easy to add this to X. We will then intend to dynamically change the refresh rate of the LCD so that, you know, if you're doing things that require lots of changes to the screen, well, we'll run at high speed and otherwise slow. It looks like to us that we need to go on day one with IPv6. The developing world has few IPv4 addresses. In India, there are places known to be five levels deep in NAT. Okay? There are universities in India who have a single IPv4 address. Now, this is not for any sane reason. I talked with Vin Cerf on this topic, and he says that their cultural problems at play here too, that a lot of these people, a lot of these countries are very, would be embarrassed if they were turned down on their allocation requests. In fact, they would get, the address allocation authorities on the internet would give them the addresses that they would ask, but they haven't been asking. But the real point is that multi-level, having YAP all over the place will make it almost impossible to manage a large-scale system. If you can't remotely diagnose a machine, then you have to have people on the ground. And at this scale, finding enough people on the ground is sort of the kiss of death. Okay. What we want is a situation where people, all over the country, all over the world, can potentially help diagnose problems. And so we want end-to-end connectivity for that reason, for collaborative applications as well. Because things like Skype now are standing on their head to manage to avoid the current cracks that have crept in due to insufficient addresses. We're still figuring out exactly what we need here, but I think we're likely to go IPv6. System management is a huge challenge. I think about this from the point of view of expertise. The field expertise may not exist in many places that we need to deploy. So we need much better, we need really better than even Project Athena scaling, which is where X is developed. And today they run like 1,700 Athena systems with 3 system managers, which sort of beats the pants out of a Microsoft environment. And LTSP has similar stories to tell. We have to have more flexibility because we don't have a huge disk. The sort of solution that LTSP or the Athena environment has is to put everything into your file system. You can't do that because the kids have to go home at night and there's only a half a gigabyte. Okay? And we also have a different principle. We want our machines to be easy to fix rather than hard to break. The reason for this is if you want the kids to actually be able to mess around with their computers and learn how to use them, then they need to be able to screw them up. Well, hopefully they don't screw them up, they'll learn not to, right? but we need it to be easy to fix rather than hard to do. The whole issues around security, authentication, privacy, and obviously, since you can't see, this is the bottom bullet on my slide, just the scale of deployment. We're really reinventing a laptop or something else. I don't know whether you care to reinvent, but this is not just stripping out stuff out of the laptop. This is a fundamentally different machine. We're trying to get the $100. We're about 135. It is much lower power than a conventional laptop. We're going to worry a lot about things like e-book reading and be able to use it in place you use a book, right? So we're really, in some sense, following the iPod revolution, NAND flash being cheap. Sunlight readable display, which is also fundamentally different. Human-powered generators to recharge the batteries if you need it. Tablet sorted mode and mesh networking. But we can't presume infrastructure. We can't install access points every place, right? We want 3 kids to be able to sit down underneath a tree, which may give them a little bit of shade, and work together with no infrastructure. Okay? We want the machines to actually be usable in that case. So things like ZeroConf and MDNS and all that stuff are technologies which thankfully are more or less able to be used now. And we intend to use them heavily. Okay, we will be using them heavily. So here's the first boards, look like this. The wireless is a little square in the upper right hand corner that will end up underneath a cam. The Marvell chip itself is just the left of that. That's the output amplifier and receiver, I guess, you have the cam. The geode itself is the big thing in the middle. There's an AMD chip. There's an extra flash chip right now. The real flash the machine will be booted from eventually is the serial flash down in the lower right-hand corner, which is like 6 pins. The ENE thing, if you see the ENE upside down, is an embedded controller for dealing with power management. There's 128, the 4 chips on the left is 128 meg of RAM. The blank space there is the Quantum Memorial. We've never built a machine with this size before. conservative engineering, so that they would not believe or were not comfortable with building a machine which didn't have a flash controller chip. They put down the pads for a flash controller chip. Well, JFFS2 is now up. So we turned on about a month ago. And 2 days after power on, Knopix booted off of the CD. Let's see, Knopix, Ubuntu, and Fedora have all run on this machine. There are some changes that need to happen. They're pretty minor. So if somebody in the Debian installer team wants to talk to me, I'd love to talk to them. Because we have some experience about where the installers fail, multiple of them. If that's okay, the Ubuntu installer is just as broken, or the Red Hat installer is just as broken as the Ubuntu one, for basically the same reasons.
How many layers does it work?
Very few. It probably has two more layers than it will in the production version, but I don't remember how many. They're doing another spin of this. We're going to build about 500 of these boards in the next 3 weeks. I'll talk about that more later. So here is just an early shot of a machine running with Linux in the background on the screen. There you go. That was, this was the first one of the first screenshots, camera version of it. So we're building about 500 boards this summer. There's lots of work to do on software. Red Hat is doing a lot of heavy lifting right now. Marcelo Tassati has joined Red Hat and is working on the whole PC. He's going to be learning a lot about the base system and how to do the install stuff. They're also putting together a Fedora derivative for the machine. You can run stock, Debian or whatnot on a conventional disk. The point is, when you have a half a gigabyte flash, you need to do work, right? So the screen should be ready about the end of August. We have time for an extra cycle of screen development. Actually, it looks like testing will start in September. We took about a month's slip on the display. So November or December is when the production testing starts, and we hope to be in full production by February of next year. The first time we'll have packaged machines, as opposed to bare boards, will be sometime in September. Early production units is this November-December date. That's when we get back the hard tooling, the injection plastic molds, that sort of thing. There's lots of work that you can do. Please join projects. I mean, most of the work needs to be done on lots of different projects, right? There's this work everywhere on memory usage and leaks, and your code will probably run faster too. There's kernel work to do, power management, out-of-memory behavior. So we really don't want to swap onto page onto flash. It really is not. It turns out NAND is a lot better than NOR, but I only got 4 megabytes a second to write to the flash. It's not a good paging device. Even and flash wears out. You really don't want to be doing lots of paging to it, even if you could. There's obviously going to be some UI work needed for power management and making sure things work well on a grayscale screen. There's huge amounts of work on localization. I will note that the current localization strategy that we all have will not scale to the entire planet. There are 347 languages in use with more than a million speakers, and we already have existence proofs of pretty near complete translations for smaller populations than that. Okay? So we need better internationalization. How we do that is a non-trivial technical problem. I don't need it next year, I need it the year after. In other words, the scale we won't have deployed into enough languages to really badly break things next year. The current processes will work, but they won't work probably the year after. And so this is a plea for somebody to really worry about it. Remember, the translation also needs to be able to be done offline as well as online. Some people, in some countries, out-of-country network access is very expensive. And so nice as Rosetta is, and I applaud the Ubuntu folks for doing it, we also need offline capability. Also note that there's no way that we're going to be able to hold up releases until we have translations of hundreds of languages. So we have to be able to do language, you know, update languages independently of base systems. We have to split the process. It's worked okay until now, sort of, to try to synchronize it all. I claim we go another factor of 3 or 5 in the number of languages, we're going to lose, and we need to start thinking about it. Obviously, educational software for kids. I'm now set up to be able to host projects at laptop.org. Very happy to do so. We sit on a gigabit per second link, so it'll be a lot more nicer than being hosted at SourceForge. Actually, there's 5 gigabit per second links leaving that building, so on different networks. So it's the MIT COA Center. So I'd like people to work together. This is a huge play edit. Independent of what the underlying distribution is, let's really try to work together on the user environment side for kids. We're building a Python GPK-based collaborative system. The intent is using all the zero-conf and MDNS kinds of facilities, so that, you know, kids can discover each other and start chatting and/or be able to trivially, you know, work together, you know, and/or a teacher might like to lead people through the web, right? So you want, you know, it's that sort of collaborative environment. There is a headache, which is I'm not convinced that it's going to be feasible to run more than one, if you will, toolkit environment at a time, given the amount of RAM. Maybe I'm wrong, but so that some people, of course, are very attached to their particular desktop environments. I will point out that for a pre-literate child, a conventional desktop is the wrong answer. Okay? Kids just learning to read need something else. We're trying to build that something else. Please come help. Okay? One of the beauties of the environment we have is it's way more flexible. We can go in and build our own user interfaces. And obviously, Debian, I don't think has to be told this, but I always make the plea, please work upstream in the projects, right? Patches downstream often never get merged upstream, right? So I'd like the work, you know, the help done in lots of different projects that need help. So as I said, we're going to have several hundred developer boards in June to distribute. We're building 500. We expect 400 of 100 of those will probably scrap out because they won't be worth trying to fix without. So we don't have production tooling equipment, test equipment. You know, the fallout rate will probably be pretty high. I'm primarily interested in people who are interested in helping on the issues that require the special hardware right now. You can do all the UI, you know, kinds of stuff on existing desktops, right? That's not a call from to me for why you need the hardware per se. Okay? There may be certain exceptions to that. For people putting together distributions, and for political reasons, we'll have to give some to the countries more directly, just in part, so they believe that the stuff is real. The Red Hat folks have put together a Fedora environment that's running under QEMU, it's actually see what libraries and so on. It's still very early days, and lots of feedback is needed on what we need in the base system. We need to throw, you know, not have a lot of old junk, okay? I don't want XT on this machine and Motif and that sort of thing. We need something that's somewhere between a conventional desktop and what we've done on PDAs, okay? That's sort of the end. So, there you go. 0 minutes. I'm done. Questions?
Which URL can we reuse about this?
Laptop.org. Somebody was very kind to give us that name. Out of the blue, they said, "Do you like laptop.org?" He said, "Sure." We know fools. Now please come help, right? There's lots of good news.
Does Jeff is to scale up to this sizes of Flash?
It turns out it does just. They Woodhouse got JFFS 2 up in the last week, and the issue is the JFFS 2 basically has to essentially scan the Flash to build its internal data structures.
Yeah, and it does build those structures in memory.
What?
And does build those structures in memory.
Yes, it does. The amount of memory it looks like it only using is a few megabytes, which is not unacceptable. It's not ideal. In the longer run, there's a new file system that's under development, but it's not mature enough to think about deploying yet. So the last mail I've read is the amount of time is looking about 8 seconds with at least a partially full file system. So. JFFS2 looks like it will scale just fine to this size. It wouldn't scale to, you know, four gigabytes of flash. You'd have to wait minutes, right?
Yeah.
So yes, it does. And that was one of the things we were worried about.
Yes, I was talking to Jim yesterday, saying there's JFFS is the other NAND flash file system, which boots a lot faster. It doesn't actually read the flash.
But it doesn't do data compression, so
it doesn't do data compression, so if your file system doesn't fit, you're screwed, you have to use JFFS2. And it uses a lot less RAM, so that's the trade-off.
JFFS2 has a lot of corner cases where it takes lots of RAM.
Yeah.
So in normal, like, if you have a really fresh JFFS2 image, it doesn't take much RAM. But once you start fragmenting and stuff, it might become really terrible.
Yeah. Yeah, the problem of why I found using the compression, if your file system when you pack up the whole thing, it carefully fits little files into the gaps, so you get really good compression, maybe 2.3 times. But then once you start editing the files and changing them, the compression doesn't get as good. So after if you just like install an image, remove a few things and put them back again, so it should be exactly the same. It's now, you know, 6 megabytes bigger than it was, which is can be a problem.
Yes, the best alternative right now is far from ideal. As I say, we'd love to use there's a file system that's under development we'd like to use, but it's not mature enough yet.
Is JFFS has had lots of problems in the system file systems bigger than 128. Like 256 is already a nightmare to boot because it actually has to go through the whole file system.
Yeah, well that's what I'm saying. It takes 8 seconds to mount half a gigabyte. That's measured now. Running on this. I mean, Dave's been doing work to make things run faster. It's way better than it was, right?
Yeah.
There also needs to be a fix for the issue of corrupted file systems, because the corrupted file system will have the JFFS2 code scan the entire disk where it can find any valid node anywhere. And that takes really ages.
Yeah, well. It's the best game in town. That doesn't mean
yeah.
We don't know. We really understand the shortcomings,
yeah.
and what we're relieved about is not having to try to stabilize the new file system in the next 6 months. It's a matter of resources. There's other people working on the next generation flash file system that looks like it should be a much better thing, but it's not soup yet.
Okay. Another thing I've learned just yesterday, because I have a USB wireless stick, a Netgear one, that there is actually a project working on embedded firmware for ARM-based wireless solutions based on the Prism chipset. Maybe it would be possible to share a bit of code with them.
What we're likely to put out there for the mesh networking is a little bit different than what we'll put out there for conventional use.
They have their own firmware and they have a small stack.
I'd like to know more about it, because I don't think that Michaelis is Lutzis, who's worried about the networking piece of the project, is aware of it. So please get me pointers if you will.
Prism54.sourceforge.net.
I'll never remember it. Could you please scribble it on the back of my on back of the business card.
You mentioned problems with the AI, not problems with the last one.
We weren't trying to install MDD devices.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
But this is just trying to dev to do it to USB devs.
Oh, okay. So we're on the problem.
There are two problems, and this is true for Debian and Red Hat. I don't know whether Ubuntu or Fedora. One of them would do a full install, but the resulting image initrd did not have the USB modules in it.
Okay.
And so if you're trying to boot off of a USB device, you're screwed. The other problem, actually, there's a kernel issue as well, which is that there's no way right now to know when a disk is spun up out on a USB bus properly.
Right.
And so you have to put in this horrible
stupid 5 second delay.
You have to put in this horrible delay, which to wait for the disk to be ready before you can actually write from it.
Okay.
So those were the issues. We saw them in both Linux distros.
These are all straightforward for that USB mount. That's what we don't work in. It still sucks.
Yeah.
Just have it safe and late.
Yeah. So these are the problems we just noticed.
Yes, right.
As we've done those problems. And so this fundamentally means that that the translations have to be able to come along when they're ready. I mean, you want to be able to add that translation as soon as it's available.
Right.
You may have had to commit to a more recent version of the system and be missing translations for three of your favorite applications, right? Now that will also incent people to help. It's a two-way street. Well, we have to make it very easy for people who are non-computer geeks to help in the translation process.
Yeah.
And it needs to be able to be done not just online a la Rosetta, but also offline. There's some offline tool whose name I forget, but I gather is making good progress. But you know, editing.po files in Emacs is not going to be an answer for some teacher in Belize. And this gentleman can tell you that that's the case. Right. We need you know, real user-friendly tools for this if we really want to make that happen all on a worldwide basis. And the whole processes around review of translations, right? How to make that scale well. There are political issues that come up in translations. Right? think about Chinese.
The input.
It's actually a big problem, I think, much bigger than most people have focused on.
Careful of translating the word free.
Yes.